Owens, thanks very much. Alongside Lynn Elmore, I am Bob Wischusen at the Liacouras Center here on the campus of Temple University. It is a packed house to watch number 19 take on number one, and we're off to a tight start already. All four Kansas points have been scored by their star point guard, Sharon Collins. He tries for three more, and he's got it. Sharon Collins with seven of his own. The only three scored so far by the Owls, a triple from Ryan Brooks, their leading scorer. So it might be the two best guards in tonight's game. Who knows? That have us off to a pretty good start.
Well, Sharon Collins has definitely been proven after last year, demonstrated he can carry his team. And as of late, he's been more of a distribute first and then pick his spots to score. But he's been very aggressive in this game, trying to establish some type of tempo for Kansas.
Xavier Henry, nice dump down. The miss inside, though, by Marcus Morris.
And Bill Self said prior to this game that because Marcus and Markieff were coming home, and it was a big to-do coming home as the number one team in the country, he expected them to be a little bit tight. And that was a missed layup right there that certainly should have been put back.
Lavoy Allen bumped. So Bill Self's team, number one in America. They've won the Big 12 the last five straight years. But this might be as stern a test as they have faced this season. And Kansas certainly has earned their number one ranking, as has Fran Dumfries' team earned their number 19 ranking, as we take a look at our star watch and two terrific guards.
Well, two guys who've led that ability to claim the ranking. Sharon Collins, we said, more of a desire to distribute, averaging 15 points over the last three games. And Juan Fernandez, a hot hand, he's hit 17 of his last 27 from beyond the arc, and Temple needs to have a big game beyond the arc.
Sharon Collins already has 7 points. He only averages about 14 per game, which is down from about 19 per game last season. But he's off to a hot start, and Bill Self said he wanted Sharon Collins to be more assertive offensively.
Yeah, Bill Self said sometimes he's disappointed that Sharon would turn down some open looks that he normally would have taken, particularly last year. But in this game, he is setting the tempo. This is the team leader. And on the other guy's floor, looking to generate some offense and looking to get guys going, Sharon Collins has demonstrated that he's a leader, bar none.
Now, statistically, these two teams are terrific defensive teams, very similar in that respect. One team averages about 63 points a game, that's Temple. The other is averaging just under 90 a game, that's Kansas. So if it's up and down, that certainly plays into Kansas's hands. So then what does Temple have to do to try and pull this upset off?
Well, they certainly have to resist the ability to go out there and try to match Kansas basket for basket. You know, if Kansas goes off in a flurry, Temple still has to come down, play more deliberate basketball. They cannot turn the ball over. We said fourth fewest in the nation in turnovers with about 10 per game. But they can't turn it over, particularly live floor turnovers that allow Kansas to get up and down in transition. And finally, we mentioned it, Juan Fernandez, more than anyone else, they need a big game, Temple does, from beyond the arc. That's how they beat Villanova, shooting 11 of 22 from three.
In his 17th year overall as a head coach, Bill Self, seventh year, though, at Kansas. And as we said, they've won the last five consecutive Big 12 titles. The only coach, or one of four coaches in NCAA history, to take three schools to an Elite Eight. Fran Dumfries, of course, he is a career Big Five guy. He's now the head coach at Temple for a long time. 17 years he was the head coach at Penn. He was a guard at LaSalle and got his master's at Villanova. If you can find a way to spend some time at St. Joe's, you have it all covered as Xavier Henry gets his first pair.
And once again, quick shot by Temple. Kansas, consummate rebounding team, plus eight on the season, and they get out on the break and get an easy transition basket. Not the way that Temple wants this game played, not the tempo by which Temple wants to play. Another quick shot. You got to move the ball, explore the Kansas defense.
That was not inside Michael Eric's range.
And it's hard, Bob, to resist the fact that a team comes down and scores in a flurry. You really want to come back and answer quickly, try to get back into the game.
Foul call that will send Marcus Morris to the line.
This quick shot, you look at Juan Fernandez, and even though you had Ryan Brooks back, lightning quick and an excellent bounce pass, the loss started a bounce pass by that guy, Sharon Collins, again. Not only is he scoring, but now he's getting everybody else involved.
Markieff Morris, one half of the Morris twins. that only grew up about a mile and a half away from where we are right now at the Liacouras Center. They won back-to-back state titles at Prep Charter School here in Philadelphia before going across the river to New Jersey and playing 1 year at the Apex Academy. But they are Philadelphia basketball players through and through. And Marcus Morris was telling us that he had 30 tickets for family members, and he was still looking for more. I think they got the total up to about 40 between the two to get as many friends and family members in as they could, because this is the first time since high school that the two have been able to come back and play in their hometown.
And it's no wonder that Bill Self believed that, you know, both brothers might be a little tight. Marcus misses a layup earlier in this game, and he's sitting down a little bit trying to get some perspective, replaced by his brother. But sooner or later, both of those guys are going to loosen up and play basketball. They've been on this floor before.
Way outside, a three on the way, comes up short from Craig Williams. Guzman on the long rebound tries one, and LaVoy Allen keeps it alive.
And right now, Temple just won 3-point field goal, and they've gotten a number of shots from beyond the arc, a number of good looks. See, big Craig Williams, number 30. Most of his field goals have been from beyond the arc.
Fernandez leans in, fouled by Sharon Collins, so that'll put Juan Fernandez at the free throw line. Now, Juan Fernandez not only has played well in his last four games, but he has had big games against big competition this season. 33 against Villanova, 21 against Seton Hall. Both of those teams were undefeated when they were taken down by Temple. He had 20 against Siena earlier this season, and Siena is a team that many thought would be a shoo-in to go to the NCAA tournament, so he has played big against the big competition.
Well, certainly the last four games, he's been in that zone, in that place, whatever you want to call it. Came into this game hitting 17 of his last 27 three-point field goal attempts. Missed a couple here today, but you know, he's the kind of guy that Kansas can't afford to heat up.
Inside, Thomas Robinson. He was number 40 on the ESPN U100 last year.
Well, throughout practice this morning, we watched Kansas work on their sets, concentrating on getting the ball inside, either to Aldridge, the Morris brothers, or Robinson, recognizing they've got a size advantage, as well as the thin bench of Temple, particularly up front.
Fernandez kept that loose ball alive. It was Guzman, hands one off. LaVoy Allen able to finish.
Big shot keeping Temple within striking distance. And I say big shot even though we've only had about 7 minutes passed in this game. Temple doesn't have the explosive score that can help them get back maybe from double-digit deficit. They've got to stay within striking distance.
Strong rebound inside by Thomas Robinson. And he draws the foul on Craig Williams. Bill Self told us earlier today, Thomas Robinson could be better than any of the big guys we've had. That's saying a lot.
Well, you look at his footwork, you know, aggressive to the basket, quick step into the lane, and didn't hesitate on the shot. He knows what his go-to shot is, and that's very important for a big guy down low.
Xavier Henry fouled by Fernandez.
Now, we've seen both teams foul the jump shooter, and we've seen both coaches jump up and say, what are you doing? You know, you challenge the shot, but you don't want to foul the jump shooter.
Three free throws for Xavier Henry.
Although, I don't know. You look at Xavier Henry's numbers. 76% from the free throw line, but 46 from beyond the arc. So sometimes you might want to pick your poison and make him make three from the line.
Well, Bill Self talked about Xavier Henry with us earlier today, talking about his efficiency. Not a lot of flash. He's just unselfish. He's got the mentality of a scorer, but beyond that, he knows also how to get his other teammates involved. He just said he's beyond everything that I thought he would be.
Well, I mean, you're looking at a guy 10th in the conference in scoring and 5th in field goal percentage. So right there, the quantitative stuff tells you that he's pretty efficient. But he doesn't show a lot of the pizzazz, as you mentioned, that you see in a lot of the freshmen today. He's straight up about business, trying to get the job done.
Sean Taylor replaces Sharon Collins for the Jayhawks.
And talking about Temple again, not having the explosive scoring. We're talking about Deontay Christmas, their big-time scorer from last year, who could carry them for a while. Good defense right there.
Guzman blocked it and took it away from Taylor. Mendez drives it. Nice feed off. LaVoy Allen can't finish, but he draws the foul. Great ball movement, though, in transition by the Owls.
The thing I like about that play is everybody in the gym knows that Juan Fernandez is a knockdown three-point shooter, including the Kansas defense. Watch him come out and challenge. He makes a quick move to the basket. Henry a little bit too slow in trying to cut off the lane and then drawing the defender. That's a basketball player's play right there.
Second foul on Thomas Robinson in as many trips. And now Robinson and Xavier Henry will sit down. Cole Aldrich comes back on.
So LaVoy Allen make one of two, but gotta remember, close game situation. Temple shoots at 64% from the line. Kansas not much better at 66. But the baskets are fewer and far between for Temple than they are for Kansas, so free throws count even more.
A jump hook won't go for Aldrich. Another rebound pulled down by Luis Guzman.
Yeah, Luis Guzman is one of those guys who's kind of a glue guy. Not going to score a lot for you, not a great shooter. Pretty good ball handler, but he gets everybody in place, and he kind of settles the team down.
Williams has a triple.
And there's Craig Williams. We talked about it, 6'9". Only 9 field goal attempts that he's taken this year have been inside the three-point line, so he can draw the big people outside and help the Temple defense offense.
Nice use of the glass by Markieff Morris.
Greg Williams stepping outside, shooting threes, gives LaVoy Allen a little more room to work on the offensive glass as well. He might be a little bit quicker a foot than Cole Aldrich. Temple back to being, you know, more of a very deliberate team right now, exploring the Kansas defense, as we mentioned they should.
Allen in the lane, kicks it back out, shot clock at 1, just beating the shot clock is Craig Williams, and he's got another 3.
And that time wide open, the big people for Kansas didn't want to come out and contest him. I think they'll think twice now.
Nice seal inside by Aldrich. Great position by a player that has improved as much, if not more, according to Bill Self, than any player he's ever had from the time he arrived to now.
You know what I liked about that play? The confidence. Last year, Cole Aldrich really wouldn't have called for the ball. His teammates would have told him, come get it. That time, he demanded it inside.
It's a classy drive by Juan Fernandez, but he couldn't finish.
And you notice Temple, an excellent job now at getting back, not allowing that secondary break. Well, we talked about the big fella, 6'9", from St. Croix. Can pull defenses out. Seldom do the big guys come out and get him. But Craig Williams says, catch me if you can, because I'm knocking him down.
Smaller club by the day, as we saw West Virginia go down yesterday. Syracuse loses at home to Pitt earlier today.
Well, guess what? I mean, notwithstanding West Virginia losing to an outstanding Purdue team, conference play is starting. And that's when the unbeatens get sorely tested within their own conference. People know them better. Scouting reports are better. Guys are more familiar with each other. So the pressure is on.
Well, Kansas has earned their number one ranking and their 12-0 record. They already have wins over Memphis, UCLA, LaSalle, Michigan, and Cal. They've won 8 of their 12 games by 25 or more. And now they're on the road to play Temple today. That's great competition earlier in your season.
It is pretty good, but I would say 10 games at home, they're 10-0. And that's the nation's longest home winning streak, so home cooking helps, no question about it. But the Temple start is really surprising. I had the opportunity to do their game against Georgetown, a game that was played in the 40s, a game that was 19-13 at halftime, a game that might go down in the annals as maybe one of the ugliest games you've ever seen, as Cole Aldrich gets caught moving on the screen. But this team has been tremendous in making other teams play ugly. Temple has, playing their kind of game, solid defense, grind it out, And if you don't have the patience to play with him, you're going to get beaten.
Well, two teams that do a tremendous job taking care of the basketball. Only two turnovers so far for Kansas, one so far for Temple, and they both average less than 13 turnovers a game.
Yeah, and we mentioned Temple, fourth fewest turnovers per game in the nation. And that has to be their game, because they're not going to knock you out. They don't have the gaudy scores. Kansas with four guys in double figures and a number of guys capable of putting points on the board.
Hernandez way off the mark from three. It's number one against number 19. Kansas on the road taking on Temple here at the Liacouras Center in Philadelphia. Temple's relatively new home arena. I'm Bob Wischusen alongside Len Elmore. Kentucky has beaten Louisville, so Kentucky stays unbeaten. Only four left. And at one point, Kansas and Texas are going to play. That comes up later on this season when they meet the Big 12. Brooks with a nice rebound as he climbed up the back of Marcus Morris to take it away.
Right now, somebody else is going to have to pick up the slack. Maybe going back to Craig Williams again, as Juan Fernandez is seeing an awful lot of blue shirts crowding him, challenging him to the point where he can't really get his shot off. And he's got a funny, almost two-handed jump shot from beyond the arc. It's easy to defend if you're in the vicinity.
Shot clock under 10 again. The boy Allen in the post on Aldrich, and Aldrich just battles the ball away from him.
You don't want to get caught flat-footed and just trying to make a move against Cole Aldrich with that 7'4 wingspan. You've got to get the ball on the move, make him move, and then go to the basket strong. Trying to back him down is useless.
Craig Williams, number 30 in white at the top of the key. Needs some help, and now he finally gets some from Juan Fernandez. Before that shot, Williams was 2-for-3. The rest of Temple's roster was 2-for-15, but now Fernandez on the board.
Another missed layup by Marcus Morris. You got to loosen up, young man. Forget that you're home. You got to get the job done. Quickly, Marcus misses a layup. Markeith is at the scorer's table getting ready to come in. I think Bill Self is trying to confuse Temple.
Sharon Collins drives it and muscles it home.
See, that's what I'm talking about with Sharon Collins. He's spent the last 5 minutes or so, after getting them off to a good offensive start, distributing the ball, playing the point as the point should be played. But in a need situation, Kansas is very fortunate that they have Sharon Collins to call on.
Again, Brooks with the shot clock at 5 down the lane, gave it up and gave it away. Sharon Collins with the steal. Morningstar for 3. He's got it. Brady Morningstar hits a triple.
Well, known as an excellent defender, Brady Morningstar back on the team. Came back December 19th after sitting out the first semester, suspended for the first semester in punishment for having been arrested for DUI. He's paid his penance. He's back with the team now. Not getting the minutes that he normally gets, but certainly a necessary cog in the Kansas attack.
Hernandez can't hit at one end, takes the ball away at the other, but gave it back up. Plus the foul. Marcus Morris with a chance to go to the free throw line to complete the three-point play as Craig Williams was called for the block.
You see that outlet pass, old school. Fernandez would have been better served to grab it. But Marcus Morris says, I can make this one. And then they knock off a team that a lot of people thought might be in the hunt in the Final Four. But again, conference play does that. Familiarity, old habits die young.
An 8-0 run for the Jayhawks. The first double-digit lead for either team here in the first half.
And again, you mentioned it, 16-2 is the Kansas advantage in the paint. They're going to their size advantage without question, but also 14-3 in fast breaks. And we said that Temple can't allow Kansas to run away from them. And right now, they're doing just that. This is danger time for Temple. Without Deontay Christmas of last year, who could carry them for several minutes.
Shot clock had wound all the way down to two, and on the drive, Guzman works his way to the free throw line.
Temple doesn't have the explosive scorer that can rescue them if they get down too far in double-digit territory.
First foul on Markieff Morris. Both Morris twins with a foul apiece. And Temple, when they don't have Juan Fernandez at the free throw line, it can get ugly. Now Fernandez will sit down. Ramon Moore will come on for the first time. So that's a 14-point-per-game score off to a slow start heading to the bench.
Well, Moore is one of those guys that Fran Dunphy hopes he catches lightning in a bottle. Came off the bench, scored 16 points in a big win against Siena. He's got the ability. You know, more of a slasher, not a big-time three-point shooter.
They leave Xavier Henry alone, and he hits a three.
That's a big-time three-point shooter. Xavier Henry shooting 46% coming into this game, shooting 46% from beyond the arc. The lefty with a prolific form.
That time by LaVoy Allen, and without Cole Aldrich in the game, he had a little more room to operate inside.
And a nice job of getting himself positioned and sealing the defender off. See what Temple can do right now, if they can slow down the attack, force Kansas to have to make a bunch of passes, Temple is a good enough defensive team, they can make some stops.
Fortunate bounce right to Marcus Morris, and he's able to lay it in.
Now if they can only make some luck for themselves.
Fran Dunphy wants a timeout. So Kansas has done about as good a job as you can do taking the crowd out of the game. And Dana O'Neill from ESPN.com has been following for the past couple of days Kansas's team, preparing an all-access feature that you can see on ESPN.com. And Dana, this must be a fun team to be around, I would think.
They are. They're a lot of fun because they like to joke with one another. They're very relaxed for a team that is number one in the nation. I mean, obviously, there's a lot of bullseye right on them, but they're also very serious businessmen. I thought it was very interesting today what Bill Self said before the pregame meal, before leaving for the game today. He said, it's going to be fun today because this is the first time you've had your manhood challenge. He's looking at this as a game where he can figure out what his team is really all about and how hard they play and how tough they are. I think that his point is, you know, they played at UCLA, not a great team. They played Memphis at St. Louis, which is a home game. This is the first time they've really been on the road against a pretty good team.
For fans of the Jayhawks, even just fans of college basketball, when you get this piece ready to go, what will we see on ESPN.com?
Well, I think you're going to see a glimpse into how kind of the nuts and bolts of how a team travels, number one, the little nuances and stuff and things it takes to get a team on the road like this, but also sort of the relationships that develop and the importance of those relationships for a team that's as good as this one trying to win a national championship.
Thanks, Dana. Tried open LaVoy Allen, and he can't hit. The tip won't go as well inside for Moore.
Well, Temple making the plays both on the offensive and defensive end. They just can't come up with possession of the ball. And you talk about Kansas having their manhood tested, according to Bill Self.
There's an answer, one of many we've seen so far.
When Temple beat Villanova, the fans start chanting, "We want Kansas, we want Kansas." And I think that resounded all the way to Lawrence, Kansas. And so Kansas players recognize that. I think the Morris brothers were the leaders and said, be careful what you wish for.
Fernandez has to force one up. In and out.
Getting the looks. Getting their hands on balls and making some plays, but that's just not good enough. Temple has to come up with some possessions, and they've got to come up with some baskets.
Sean Taylor drives, and it's too easy right now for the Jayhawks. They've made 7 field goals in a row, opened up a 15-point lead, and another timeout called by Fran Dunphy. Thursday, January 7th, ABC delivers the City BCS National Championship game. Will Heisman winner Mark Ingram lead Nick Saban's Crimson Tide to the promised land? Or can Texas senior quarterback Colt McCoy take the Longhorns to a national championship. The City BCS National Championship game on ABC Thursday, January 7th at 8 Eastern. As we take a look at the comparison between the two programs, they've combined for 16 national championships, but a dozen of those go to Alabama. And the most amazing thing, you go with 12 national championships and 31 bowl wins, and this year Mark Ingram wins the first ever Heisman Trophy at Alabama. With all the great players they've had, they had never won a Heisman.
Well, I think maybe it's been the fact that they've had multiple great players on that team, and some of them have stolen votes. And many times during their halcyon years, it was Bear Bryant that got the biggest, for the greatest focus, and they didn't give out Heisman's for coaches, did they? I'll tell you what, during that timeout, I expected Fran Dunphy to tell his guys, look, we can't go away from our game plan, per se. Yeah, we might change up the defense a little bit, but we still have to be patient, still have to look for our shots, we just got to knock them down. And defensively, don't give up on the effort. Nice job right there.
Aldridge can't hit, and just as you said that, a deep three was tossed up, and it's a one-and-done each trip right now, it seems, for Temple.
Well, they've got to take the open threes. The question is, have they given themselves enough time to get the best possible shot?
A 17-4 run right now for Kansas. They have a 15-point lead on the road here at Temple. Very much a 15-point lead for number one as Kansas in control on the road here at Temple. Bob Schusen alongside Len Elmore. Fernandez tries another three. This one's no good. That already is the 14th three that Temple has shot here in the first half.
As we mentioned, they need to have a big game from beyond the arc. That's how they were able to engineer the upset against Villanova. Played very well against Siena.
Inside by Marcus Morris.
Well, we talked about Kansas, not only the size advantage, but up front, they have a mobility advantage. As both the Morris twins are able to put the ball on the floor and go where they need to go. And then you got the 7-4 reach of Cole Aldridge that's really denied LaVoy Allen. Oh, that was a nice job of Allen fight for that offensive rebound.
In the corner to Brooks. He can't hit from three. An offensive rebound though for Guzman. Is this the formula for Temple to get back in the game, kick it back out, and shoot nothing but threes?
Well, if they're guys who are receiving the ball are the three-point shooters, yeah, you got to knock those down. But certainly you need to play inside out. That was a good example right there. Get the best available shot. Bill Self, not real happy. This team is doing a yeoman's job on the defensive end, but I think Bill's looking for perfection.
Men's college basketball continues Monday night, 7 Eastern. It's a battle in the Big East. Ashton Gibbs in Pittsburgh will take on Lance Stevenson and the Bearcats of Cincinnati. A Monday night clash in the Big East at 7 Eastern on ESPN. For more information, you can log on to ESPN.com. It may have been all the offensive rebounds keeping that possession alive that angered Bill Self, but he has not had much to be angry about. 48 hours ago, these six teams were unbeaten. Well, you can take Syracuse and West Virginia off that list. Now, Kentucky was able to hold on and beat Louisville earlier today, but out of these four, you think Kansas is the best, or do you think Texas might not be getting as much respect?
Well, I think the top three are no disrespect to Purdue, but I think when you look at personnel, you look at size, you look at dominance inside as well as ability to knock down shots from beyond the arc, I think the three teams, Kansas, Texas, and Kentucky, pretty close.
Aldridge muscles one up inside.
See, you can't have that, the second chance opportunity. You know, Temple really expends a lot of energy playing defense. And right here, again, it was a stretch to try to say, okay, let's get it to at least 10 or below. You know, they just need to answer right now.
Guzman drives, Aldridge blocks it again, and then a foul called against Temple and LaVoy Allen. Cole Aldridge averages 3.8 blocks per game.
You saw that coming. And again, Cole Aldridge, a shot blocker par excellence. He's got great instinct. He saw the penetration all the way. Didn't leave his man until Guzman committed and then came over. like the good shot blocker and a support help that he should be.
It was funny talking to Bill Self earlier today about Cole Aldrich. He said, when we got him, it's hard to say when you're a McDonald's All-American that you're a project, but he wasn't very good. And we just left him out there against all those guys that went to the NBA and let them beat him up during practice every day. We wouldn't let him sub out. We were hard on him, but he realized he was getting better, and now he's as good a big man as there is in the country and came into the year as the preseason Big 12 co-player of the year with Sharon Collins.
Well, all that pressure yielded a diamond, particularly on the defensive end. And his coming out party was the 2008 national championship game against North Carolina, where he pretty much handled Tyler Hansbrough, took him out of the basketball game. And I think people's eyes opened and everybody awakened to the name Cole Aldrich.
Down to the last 7 seconds of the first half. Guzman throws it into the knees of LaVoy Allen, and it's a turnover, and that will end the first half. And an impressive one it was for Kansas and the Morris twins. Marcus Morris and Markeith Morris both with solid first halves. Marcus with 9 points on 4 of 7 from the field. A 21-6 run for the Jayhawks to close the first
this game.
Sharon Collins scored his team's first 7 points and finished with 9 in the first half. He's already been in double figures 9 out of Kansas's first 12 games. He was the Big 12 preseason co-player of the year along with Cole Aldrich. And that's where the Jayhawks go to start the second half, right down to the big man in the post. But he hits the side of the backboard.
Well, the key for this second half for Temple, if they can get back into this down 17, is they've got to slow this game down to almost a standstill. Grind it out. Make Kansas have to grind it out, not give the easy, quick baskets. Force them to play some offense, move the ball a little bit, hope you can get some stops and come down on the other end, knock down some threes. The three ball is still a huge part of this Temple attack. And if they're going to come back, they're going to have to knock some down, just 4 of 16 to finish that first half.
Eric draws the foul. Cole Aldrich is called for his second.
You know, if I'm Fran Dunphy, I implore my guys to start making 2, 3, 4 passes. Again, to explore the Kansas defense, get the best possible shot. And then on the other end of it, playing defense, I've got to slow them down.
Brooks misses a three, and Aldrich stepped on the baseline. Specifically, though, for Juan Fernandez, who's now 1 for 10. He missed his first attempt to start the second half. Is there something that they can do to get him specifically either better looks or in more of a rhythm?
Well, I think once he receives the ball, we saw him in the first half make a nice move, give a little bit of a head fake, drive to the basket and create something. He's got to get some easy baskets, maybe a layup or two, make him feel better.
And now Guzman standing on the baseline when Fernandez found him.
You know, when a shooter's not shooting the ball well, they tell you to keep shooting, but it's not the question of whether you shoot more shots. It's the question of the quality of shots that you take. And when you have offers or one-fers, you got to try to get a couple of layups, get a couple of easy baskets. Now those numbers start to improve, and you start to gain some confidence.
Aldrich has it slapped away, and it's tracked down in the corner by Ryan Brooks. Guzman's kick out, knocked away by Tyshawn Taylor.
Boy, Tyshawn Taylor sniffed that one out on the penetration instead of dropping back to help, as would be the habit of a defender, getting the paint and help out on the drive. He stayed outside because he knew the kick out was coming.
Backdoor cut for Brooks. He fades away and connects. The first points of the second half scored by Temple.
And there you see offense coming off of several passes. You know, I don't care how good a defensive team you are, offense can get you out of position to get a good look if they're patient enough.
Sharon Collins answers at the other end. He's in double figures for the 10th time in 13 games.
And once again, leading the way for his team. I mean, this is a young man doing the NCAA tournament last year. Almost carried this team, he and Cole Aldrich. Got all the way to the final 8.
Finally, the second field goal for Juan Fernandez.
That'll open his eyes a little bit.
Jumper comes up short for Morris, but the long rebound tapped out to Taylor. He drives it and turns it over. Hasn't done much of that the past 2 weeks.
And you see, that's what I mean right there about making Kansas grind it out, make them use.
Another block as Aldridge pins the drive. Taylor at the other end will go to the free throw line as he's bumped by Luis Guzman. But Michael Eric off balance, and Aldridge takes advantage.
Well, you're going to take a look at the draw right there. I mean, play right here to step in. Nice job defensively of just being able to keep an eye on the driver. That's good center instinct. Maintain contact with your man, but also come to every bit of penetration. And Cole Aldridge has terrific instinct. Take a look at it now, real time. Eric never really got, you know, any lift on the drive. He was almost leaning for the basket, which made it a little bit easier. And I think the officials better check the inflation of that basketball, because I think Cole Aldridge took all the air out of it with that pin.
Well, the average is about 4 blocks per game, and that's a big reason why this is the number 2 defensive team of all the Big 12 teams to go along with the number 1 offensive team. Another miss from Fernandez.
Yeah, he just looks as though he's rushed right now, and you give Tyshawn Taylor a lot of credit because he's challenging every shot, not an open look.
Pick and roll. That is as pretty as it gets from the 2 co-players of the year preseason in the Big 12.
And they're doing it against a pretty superior defensive team. Temple only allows 54 points and 36% from the field for opponents. Are you just going to take a look right here? Pretty simple. Cole Aldridge is going to step out right there, get the high screen. Fernandez gets picked off, and LaVoy Allen doesn't know whether he should stay with the shooter or stay with his man. Either way, appeared he was going to get burned.
Temple offensively. Fernandez freed up for 3.
He's rushing it now. He's not taking his time. He doesn't have his feet underneath him. And he's almost just launching instead of shooting it.
Nice entry pass by Morningstar. Unable to hit was Marcus Morris.
And that's the 3rd layup that Marcus Morris has missed right around the basket. Not that it makes much of a difference at this stage. When you talk about miscommunication,
there's Marcus Morris. Little showtime as things get embarrassing now for Temple. Ryan Brooks tried to toss a pass out to LaVoy Allen, and he hit Craig Williams right in the face. The loose ball ends up with Marcus Morris, and he's able to find himself a highlight.
I tell you, when things aren't going right, you might as well pack it in.
49-27, number 1 Kansas has the lead here at Temple, and joined again now by Dana O'Neill, who works not only for ESPN.com, but has an all-access piece with the Jayhawks coming out on Tuesday, and had a chance to catch up with Bill Self at halftime.
Yeah, he was very pleased with his defense, obviously, for obvious reasons. They're the most in tune his team has played defensively in a really long time. Said that, you know, they're just playing very, very hard. Offensively, he's very happy as well. Said he wants to keep going inside and then hanging tough at the rim. He said they can play even harder at the rim and really open things up, I think, this half.
Have you gotten a feel for how special this homecoming is for the Morris twins, being able to come back and play here in Philadelphia?
Yeah, absolutely. I spoke with them a little bit last night. They said they had about 40 people coming tonight. They had their barber come in last night, a guy named Dan from North Philly, for a quick cut. And, yeah, they're really excited to be back in the neighborhood.
Trapped at the hotel, they weren't allowed to go to the barber themselves?
That's exactly it. They were on lockdown, not even Dunkin' Donuts. So they had to go have barber come in.
Thanks, Dana. We appreciate it. Again, Dana O'Neill will have the all-access piece coming out on Tuesday on ESPN.com. Trailing after the Jayhawks for a couple of days. Trying to keep things alive on the offensive glass with Scootie Randle. As Temple fighting for some respect right now. They have fallen behind 49-27.
Well, that's the way you have to play it if you're Kansas, number one team in the nation. Even if you guys are coming home, you got to sequester them. You don't want any distractions. And those are the kinds of shots in one-to-one Fernandez just hit. Those are the kinds of shots that will hope, at least for the Temple faithful, they will hope that that will get him going a little bit.
Backdoor cut, Xavier Henry goes baseline, and he has 10.
But for a good defensive team right now, that's two times now, lack of communication on the screen and roll that resulted in Cole Aldridge dunk. And there on just a pass and a cut, nobody talked. And you get a wide open pass to the basket. That's not good habits for a good defensive team.
LaVoy Allen with a chance for a three-point play. 51-31. Kansas, though, has the lead as we take a look at our star watch. Sharon Collins with 12 points, and he's part of an ensemble. Juan Fernandez really needs to be a part of a group that carries Temple, and he's 1-for-7 from behind the arc. Down by 20. A chance for a three-point play, though, for LaVoy Allen. And a Temple team that at this point is 11 of 40 from the field, only shooting 28%. That Kansas defense has been solid, Len, at the other end.
It certainly has, and has been solid both inside and out. And Temple hard-pressed to establish anything on the offensive end. I think the course might be now to start to go to LaVoy Allen, at least try to establish some inside out, get their three-point shooters some better looks. Defensive end still forced Kansas to try to grind it out a little bit, take some time.
Shot clock down to 8.
There's still enough time to do that.
Collins has to force one up. The shot clock at 2. That was one of the better defensive trips we've seen for Temple.
And that's what they need to do. Now, of course, once they get going offensively, they have to quicken the pace as far as putting up their shots, lest they run out of time. But that was the type of defensive stance they have to make.
Brooks tries a 3. He's got it. Can Temple fight their way back into this game?
It all depends on what happens on this end of the floor. Once again, forcing Kansas to make a lot of passes. LaVoy Allen trying to battle Cole Aldridge down low. Got to play position basketball. Although Cole Aldridge, he doesn't mind bumping and grinding down low either.
LaVoy Allen's third personal foul. So that's a little bit of trouble for Fran Dunphy, because he needs to be able to play physical under there if he's going to fight with Cole Aldridge. But now he's getting into foul trouble. And with 13:20 to go in the second half, Fran Dunphy is going to go to the bench. Allen will sit down as Michael Eric comes back on.
That's a whole lot of trouble right there. LaVoy Allen, one of the top defensive players in the Atlantic 10 down low. He can also put the ball in the basket. Michael Eric, not necessarily the best defender, and certainly can't score at the rate LaVoy Allen scores.
Sean Taylor knocks it down. He has 6 points and 5 rebounds. 53-35. Kansas has the lead. Brooks has it slapped away. Markieff Morris nearly steals it.
So there's a shortcoming in Ryan Brooks' game. He had an opportunity with that ball fake to go blow right by his man. Was he hesitant to put it on the floor?
Scootie Randle tries a 3 with 3 on the shot clock. Eric keeps it alive on the offensive glass. And then a tough pass to handle. Guzman for 3. No good. Markieff Morris.
Can't settle for the jump shots if you're Temple right now. If you're wide open, that's one thing. You got a defender closing. You got to show him the ball. You got to put it on the floor, make the defense adjust.
Tyrell Reed, he's got a 3. Boy, they come at you from every possible angle.
Like they say on the playgrounds of Philly and everywhere else, that's money. You get the wide open shot, you can count it.
They just come at you in waves. There's not a guy on this team when they're on the floor that isn't a threat to score. Brooks can't hit.
And again, Temple relegated to a jump shooting team, playing right in the hands of Kansas at this stage. One and done, Kansas is down the other way.
Fight, 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 fight. easy one into the post looking for Aldridge. 3 won't go either.
They just can't capitalize. The Owls can't capitalize with points off of turnovers. They're creating some turnovers.
Taylor left alone. He hits. This is a clinic. And a timeout called by Fran Dunphy.
Yeah, it's a clinic, all right. A basketball clinic given by Kansas, and the Owls feel like they're getting wheels on a gurney into the clinic.
Thursday, January 7th, ABC delivers the City BCS National Championship game. Will the Heisman winner, Mark Ingram, lead Nick Saban's Crimson Tide to the promised land, or can Colt McCoy pull what might be a mild upset and have the Longhorns win a national championship? The City BCS National Championship game on ABC, Thursday, January 7th at 8 Eastern. How many times has a team had a Heisman winner and a national champion in the same season? Matt Leinart did it in 2004 at USC. Charles Woodson from Michigan when they won the Rose Bowl. Hasn't happened often. And it never happened before, obviously, for Alabama, because Mark Ingram is the first ever Heisman winner for the Crimson Tide.
And that would be a cherry on top of an outstanding season. Alabama, you know, getting by Florida. Most everybody's money at the beginning of the season was the odds-on favorite to win the national championship.
Shot clock down to 7. Fernandez realized it. Bullet pass into the post. LaVoy Allen can't get it to go. Each of these teams has made 5 threes, Len. The difference for Kansas, they're 5 for 8. Temple's 5 of 24.
Yeah, and we mentioned at the beginning of the telecast, Temple, their reliance on the three-point shot in big game situations was going to tell the tale. They needed a big game from beyond the arc. Certainly didn't get it.
Offensive rebound for Thomas Robinson, but then he traveled. And we have a timeout on the floor. Number one looking very much like it. 58-35. Kansas in control here at Temple. This time around for Bill Self.
Yes, that was then, and this is now. And he's got some balance here. He's got some size. He's got some guys capable of putting the stop on individuals. Outstanding perimeter defense. And certainly he's got the shot blocker to erase mistakes in the back. Somebody's got to make themselves available.
Under 10 again. Brooks launches. Can't hit.
Shot clock runs down. You got to have somebody who can slash to the basket. The defense is already set. You know, if you're just going to take a perimeter shot, you're just inviting a one and out possession. Put it on the floor. Go someplace where you can find some folks. That's what Kansas has been able to do. And the shot clock runs down.
Marcus Morris. Pretty shot in the lane. The Morris twins look like different young men than they did clearly a couple of years ago. And when you get 40 tickets, one better go to mom. There's Thomasine Morris, who gets a chance to see her boys play here for the first time as members of the Jayhawks, as Fernandez can't hit again. But both of the Morrises, after their season ended last year, went to the strength coach for Kansas and said, look, we want to get bigger and better. And they have both added about 15 to 20 pounds of muscle. I remember on ESPN doing the Jordan Classic at the Garden a couple of years ago when they were just coming out of the Apex Academy and going to Kansas. And they just, if you saw them side by side with pictures in that program and the pictures now, the 15 to 20 pounds of muscle looks like 40 pounds. I mean, it just, they added so much width to their bodies that now they look like legitimate big-time BCS Conference Division I basketball players.
Well, you can kind of look at their arms right there. You know, Markeith and Marcus, you know, your typical pretty good high school seniors. But when you get to a championship program like that, that is the natural progression. It's all about commitment. It's all about the desire to become better. And I think the fact that they went to the strength and conditioning coach instead of them coming to them, it makes all the difference in the world, because that's where you get the commitment.
And he Andrew Hootie is the strength and conditioning coach for Kansas, moving over from UConn in the past couple of years.
Yeah, there's a little tie-in there. Lou Perkins, the athletic director here at Kansas, formerly the athletic director at University of Connecticut. So he knew where all the gems were.
Sharon Collins, air ball from three, but on the weak side, missing was Thomas Robinson. And it goes over to Kansas with a fresh shot clock with 8:12 to go. Fran Dunphy's Temple Owls had hoped for a lot better in their meeting with number one Kansas here at the Liacouras Center on Temple's campus. Papa Schusen alongside Len Elmore watching the top-ranked team in America play like the top-ranked team in America should when they're on the road. And only Texas, Kentucky, and Purdue still among the group of unbeatens along with the Jayhawks.
Well, you can go down the checklist. You know, outstanding defense, both individually and team defense. You know, terrific balance on offense. You know, there's not a weak spot out there on the floor. And then you look at the depth. So you combine those factors together. This is the number one team in the nation thus far, coming on the other guy's floor. Getting ready to finish.
Of course, he spent 17 years on the sidelines at Penn, won 310 games, took them to the tournament 9 times. Takes over for a Hall of Fame coach and John Chaney here at Temple. And by the way, he got his master's degree at Villanova. If he could just go park cars for a day at St. Joe's or do something over there, he'd have all 5 Big Five schools covered. It's the only one he's missed out on. And Xavier Henry will go to the line with a chance for a 3-point play. This is not the best day that Fran Dunphy spent on the sidelines, though, at any school.
Now you take a look at him as a player. I mean, at that point, he was probably in control of what can go on the floor. Right now, this is the most frustrating part. You know, little or no control at this stage of the game. You can only tell him what to do.
Well, in talking to Bill Self earlier today about Temple and about the season they've had so far, what was the first thing he said? Hey, Fran Dunphy, he can coach.
Sure. I mean, Fran Dunphy, one of the most respected coaches in America. You mentioned what he was able to accomplish at an Ivy League school at Penn, and then coming here and picking up where the legend John Chaney had left off as far as NCAA appearances in 4 years, 2 NCAA appearances. You know, coming back, win A-10 championships over the last couple of years.
Chance for a 3-point play for Ryan Brooks.
And that's what I'm talking about. They may not have done it off the dribble, but the penetration is so important. And you're just going to take a look right here, just a pass to the corner and then a cut straight down the middle off a curl. And Brooks beats Cole Aldrich, who uncharacteristically a half a step slow getting to the penetration. Let's see the offensive player get in front of him, and that's when he gets in trouble.
LaVoy Allen out, earlier Jefferson on after Brooks completes the 3-point play.
Temple now trying to employ last 7:35, going to employ some full court pressure. I think Fran's going to do this until he's exhausted his team.
Xavier Henry stepped on the baseline before inbounding the ball, so.
So the turnover. The freshman is human. He can make a mistake.
Nice dump down pass, and the reverse won't go. Moore was able to find earlier Jefferson, but Jefferson couldn't squeeze it home. Brother to brother, C.J. Henry hits a triple off the feed from Xavier.
Talk about some talent on that family. Two outstanding basketball players, and C.J. Henry, an outstanding baseball player as well.
He's kind of trapped in the Yankees organization behind Derek Jeter as a shortstop, but I bet he shoots it better than Derek Jeter. If they played a horse, I think C.J. Henry would have a chance.
I don't know. Derek Jeter is quite the competitor. He played a little basketball himself now.
Fade away. Marcus Morris can't hit. Cole Aldrich. That's a high percentage shot.
Once again, on demonstration, the strength and the size. of the Kansas front line.
Moore fouled on that drive, and men's college basketball continues on Monday night at 7 Eastern. Two excellent Big East teams will match up in Cincinnati as Pittsburgh goes on the road to take on the Bearcats. For more information, you can always log on to ESPN.com. But we'll watch Ashton Gibbs square off with Lance Stevenson Monday night at 7. Brooks floats to the corner. Finds Juan Fernandez. In and out. It's been that kind of day for Juan Fernandez. And a turnover. Xavier Henry can't hit the layup, but it goes over to Temple.
Well, on that last Temple possession, you see what putting the ball on the floor and making even some effort to penetrate does. It forces the defense to shift, try to overcompensate for the driver, and to get some people open. I mean, this is now a learning situation for Temple. They can use this for the next game.
Strong drive by Scootie Randle.
Still playing hard, though, and that's the hallmark of belief in the coach, respect for the coach, and respect for your teammates. And that's for both teams.
Xavier Henry hand-checked by Ryan Brooks.
That's his second team foul.
15 foul on Temple. And Xavier Henry, not the flashy player that John Wall is. I mean, John Wall is a highlight reel waiting to happen for Kentucky, but Xavier Henry averaging 16 points a game for the number one team in America. You wonder, as you move through this season, you start thinking about freshman of the year, if the voters are going to look at production as much as you're going to look at the flash and the highlight reel that certainly John Wall can put together.
Yeah, I mean, and you take a look again, the numbers, at least minutes, points, field goal percentage are very similar. Obviously, they play different roles. Xavier Henry is not the playmaker. John Wall is. But by the same token, Xavier Henry, if he improves on rebounding a little bit more, you know, he has blended into this team with championship caliber, blended in very nicely. And as you mentioned, not a gaudy player. He's not going to open people's eyes. And in many ways, you know, you make the comparison here about who's most efficient, who's most effective, who contributes to its team's success. And I'd say it's about a hair's bit of difference between the two.
So Cole Aldrich goes to the line to shoot a pair. It's now a one-on-one situation. So another free throw for Cole Aldrich, and it would be his sixth double-double in the first 13 games. He's also now had three blocks or more in 12 of Kansas's 13 games. And there's your double-double. Yeah, 21 doubles last season and a breakout sophomore year. C.J. Henry fouls Juan Fernandez.
Well, the way C.J. Henry is playing Juan Fernandez is the way Juan Fernandez has been played all afternoon, whether it's Tyshawn Taylor, whether it's Brady Morningstar, you know, who are outstanding defenders. C.J. Henry, the same thing. Crowd him as he's handling the ball, not allow him to really have any daylight. Shoot the jump shot, and you take your chances with the drive.
1-1 for Juan Fernandez, and it's been a nightmare of an afternoon, evening, as you could see, 3-for-16 from the field. As Brooks sits down, TJ DeLeo comes on. But Juan Fernandez, Argentinian, and his father was a 17-year pro in Argentina, and they actually sought the advice of Pepe Sanchez when he was deciding what to do about college. And not shockingly, he ends up at Temple, where Pepe Sanchez went. But Juan Fernandez had offers to go to a couple of different professional teams in Spain. And it's very easy sometimes for the players, according to Pepe Sanchez, to turn down college and go for the money and just play in Europe, especially considering the amount of money and how crucial it can be to some South American families and their financial situations. But Juan Fernandez opted to come to America. short, ripped away inside, and the finish by Ramon Moore.
As I said, it'll be very easy to pack your bags and give it up if you're Temple. Come back another day, but you got to admire guys who are definitely putting forth the effort. Morning star back from his suspension in the first semester. He, along with Tyshawn Taylor, these guys have been locked down defenders on the perimeter, as we can attest to looking at the production of Juan Fernandez and Ryan Brooks for Temple. So you pull all that together, these guys are just getting better. Now, when you compare them to Texas, I mean, Texas has pretty much the same factors. They've got an array of stars, you know. Damian Jones is outstanding, as well as Dexter Pittman inside, but they've got other guys around them that are continuing to develop. It is a collision course that I know you won't miss, and I'm certainly going to find a way. If I'm not working that night, I'm going to find a way to watch that game.
You're just assuming I'm not working that night?
No, I know you're going to watch it.
I could be busy.
You could be.
Probably not.
I'm not making the schedule, though. It is a Monday, by the way, so you tell me. Now, I know I'm not working. It was a Monday. I'm not working that night.
Guzman goes to the free throw line.
Maybe we'll watch it together.
That sounds great.
You're in the neighborhood.
It's the combination, I think, for Kansas offensively and defensively that's so impressive. The fact that they're able to score at this rate. You can see Texas puts up the same kinds of numbers. You know, their defensive numbers aren't basically the same range, but so far this season, only one out of 13 opponents against Kansas has even shot over 40%, and it was Radford.
Yeah.
And it's really just because at the end of the game, it's garbage time, and Radford hits a couple of shots and squeezes the shooting percentage over 40, but now you're playing the number 19 team on the road today. They've already beaten LaSalle, Memphis, UCLA, Michigan, Cal, all of those teams. Kansas has held under 40% from the field.
Yeah, and Kansas is holding up their bargain and putting some distance between those top four undefeated teams who have very much deserved of the top four spots. You know, we're talking also besides Texas, we're talking Kentucky as well as Purdue. But in the end, it's about the scoring margin. So many people put an emphasis on points allowed, and that's fine. A lot of teams can control tempo, as Temple does, and it's not to take anything away from Temple's defense, but they're controlling tempo. When you can run the floor like Kansas, you can exploit turnovers, you can get out and get fast break points off of rebounds and create that kind of scoring margin. You're playing some defense and you're dominating.
DeLeo, the rebound after Thomas Robinson missed the dunk inside. A blocking foul now called on C.J. Henry. C.J. Henry played 4 years of baseball in the Yankees organization. He was a first-round pick in 2005 by the Yankees, but of course, they have a relatively well-known shortstop, so he ends up being part of a pretty well-known trade.
And playing behind another well-known shortstop, playing in the minors, thinking that he'll get a chance. If you're sitting back there thinking that in the next 3, 4, 5 years, you're going to get a chance in the majors if you're in the Yankee organization or the Phillies organization to play shortstop, you're pretty much mistaken. I think that's what drove C.J. Henry back to basketball, playing behind Derek Jeter and Jimmy Rollins. I don't know. I don't think so.
He went to Memphis for a year, but was a medical redshirt. And then after John Calipari left Memphis, he and Xavier was kind of slated to go to Memphis as well. As C.J. hits a bomb from the corner, they switched over to Kansas, and it was kind of that trickle-down effect. That's how Lance Stevenson ended up going to Cincinnati, because he was signed, sealed, and delivered. Basically, everyone knew it to go to Kansas, but then when Xavier Henry switched over to go to Kansas, Stevenson said, well, we kind of play the same position. And he ends up at Cincinnati playing Mick Cronin.
Well, blood is thicker than everything else, and in the media guide in Kansas, it also informs us that both of their parents went to Kansas as well, so it's not a coincidence.
There is a good amount of Kansas fans at this game this afternoon. You can start to hear the Rock Chalk Jayhawk in the background. It's a pretty impressive showing by the fans here on the road.
Yeah, they're out here in full force and enjoying every second of this last 146.
Foul on the floor. floor, so Elijah Johnson will shoot free throws, and ESPN's coverage of college basketball continues next. We're heading to Cancun. It's a nice time of year to be down there if you're Seton Hall and Virginia Tech, so Big East takes on ACC in the Cancun Governor's Cup. That's coming up next. More college basketball here on ESPN.
That is quite the trip. How do we swing that one, man?
I thought, sitting next to you, you're pretty good at getting the plum assignments. That
I appear to be the cold weather guy.
Jeremy Azell has gone off so far this season. Second leading scorer in the Big East, 12th in the country for Seton Hall. That's a Seton Hall team that Temple beat.
Yeah, I mean, Bobby Gonzalez has got his guys playing with a great deal of effort. You know you're going to see full court pressure. You know you're going to see up-tempo basketball. Their problem has been not able to close the deal. A couple of really close losses in Big East play. But nevertheless, dangerous, and with Hazel explosive.
Elijah Johnson fouled again. So Juan Fernandez certainly hoped for better against the number one team in America. And how good are you, and how deep are you if you're Kansas? You've got Elijah Johnson, who was a consensus top 30 prospect at point guard in our ESPNU top 100 last year. He was number 28, true freshman from Las Vegas. And he can't find minutes till it's a 30-point game with about 6 minutes to go. You're deep if you've got a player this good on the end of your bench.
Oh, there's no question about it. And you tip your cap to Bill Self. I mean, being able to juggle and manage playing time and attitudes and egos. He's got 10 players that play 11-plus minutes. And for a lot of guys in a lot of programs, that may not be enough. But when you're a proven winner and good players get opportunities, they'll sit with it for a while.
Now, Kansas coming up next has Cornell. Then they'll be at number 14, Tennessee, next week. And things are still materializing for Bruce Pearl's program after Tyler Smith, along with Melvin Goines, the junior point guard, junior center Brian Williams, and sophomore guard Cameron Tatum were all arrested during a traffic stop over the weekend. All four charged with misdemeanors. All four were charged with misdemeanor gun possession, and Goines and Williams will face misdemeanor drug possession charges as well after the police that pulled them over smelled marijuana, did a search of the car, found a gun, and found a bag of marijuana. On top of that, they were driving a rented car. So now there are questions as to it was a friend of one of the players who had rented the car, whether or not those players driving that car might even be classified as an improper benefit. All of this for Bruce Pearl, and he responded by saying they're all suspended indefinitely, and he told our own Andy Katz that he's extremely disappointed. It's embarrassing for the program and the university. So it could be a very shorthanded Tennessee team that faces Kansas next weekend as well.
Yeah, it's a sad chapter. Young men, you could say making mistakes, but some of the things with which they are charged, those are mistakes that, you know, there's no excuse for. And unfortunately for the Tennessee program, you start peeling away that onion, and it's going to be layer after layer of issues. And that's not the first time. Tennessee football has had some issues involving criminal justice as well. So we just hope for the best as far as the innocent involved, and you hope that those who have created the problems, you know, get justice, but also learn a lesson.
Chase Buford fouled by Rafael De Leon. One of two at the line for Buford. And Chase Buford is now the 12th different player to score for Kansas. Moore fouled by Buford with 23 seconds to go. And Len Elmore, if I would have told you that Kansas was going to come in and win this afternoon, you probably wouldn't have been surprised. But if I would have told you they were going to come to a place this difficult for opponents normally to play and win by 34,
I would have been mildly surprised simply because we knew that it would take a couple of super efforts by Temple. One, not to give up fast break points, turnovers in the open floor or off the rebound to get back defensively. They would have to certainly have a huge game from beyond the arc. No question about that. And we knew that Kansas certainly outsized them, if you will, and if they were able to establish themselves in the paint, it's going to be a long day for Temple. All three of those things happened for Temple, unfortunately, in the same game. And that's why we have the score that we have. But Kansas definitely demonstrates that they're the number one team in the nation right now, as you mentioned, coming into a tough place to play and winning decisively.
Bill Self's team stays among the ranks of the unbeaten. There are only four left, and they do it in style. A 32-point win for number one Kansas here at the Liacouras Center. And Temple struggles, to say the least, on their home floor. 84-52 is our final. For more on our game, you can tune to ESPN News for a post-game extra.